Welcome, everybody. As you're getting on, feel free to put your name and where you're tuning in from in the chat if you'd like. We'll get started in just a moment. All right. I think we can start getting into it. This is such a beautiful chat. I could just watch this go on and on, but we can keep the chat active as we start this celebration. So welcome everyone to this 100th anniversary of Daniel Berrigan's birth and also the celebration of the publication of Celebrant's Flame, Daniel Berrigan in Memory and Reflection, written by Bill Wylie-Kellermann. I wish that we could all be together tonight. This would be a really good party, I can already tell. But at least we can be gathered here in our own little spaces. And we all come here with different relationships to Dan. Some of you got to know him very well, to work with him or learn from him. Some of you got to party with him in real life. And some of us never got to meet him or maybe just heard his name for the first time today. But we all come here to celebrate his life and also his life commemorated in this beautiful book, which is such a rich feast of stories and relationships. And I think it's very safe to say that his presence is here with us all tonight, somehow sneaking in between our Zoom screens, I think. So I'm Kateri and I'm speaking out of Detroit, called Wawayatnong by the native Anishinaabe peoples. And I'm a few blocks from the Detroit Catholic Worker House where I lived for the last couple years, and just a couple miles from Bill's home, who has been a co-conspirator through that work. And I'm one of the co-contributors of this book, and we'll get to hear from many others throughout the night as well. So I'm one of the ones who never got to meet Dan, but I feel like I've gotten to know him over the years through so many stories shared by many who knew him, but especially through Bill, who has shared of Dan so lovingly and freely, as if he were introducing us as friends, one of us having died a few years ago being no major obstacle to building the relationship. And as I was writing the afterword, I even found myself referring to him as Dan rather than Berrigan, which I remember thinking like, is this okay? Am I allowed to do that? It felt kind of presumptive or sacrilegious, but Bill gave me the go ahead and I started to kind of think of that naming, that sense of just innate familiarity as a testament to both the way that Dan lived his life, which was so present and so humble, and also a testament to Bill's loving witness and willingness to invite all of us into this friendship between him and Dan, which is what so much of the book is about. And I consider both Bill and Dan to be elders in this work. Spending time with the book allowed me to think more about the relationship that I have with elders, what it means for us as the next generation to have elders, to allow ourselves to be eldered. And I write in here about having a complicated relationship with Christianity, which I'm finding more and more common among many millennial folk if they have a relationship with Christianity at all. So many of us were born with iPhones in hand and are part of this really rapid and kind of obsessive tendency with social media about the new and the shiny, and have been taught to be suspicious of anything that kind of whiffs of age, which definitely includes the Bible, unfortunately. So even though I was raised in these radical Christian spaces, I myself was quite slow in the upkeep. And it really has been through these elderships with folks like Bill and through him, Dan, that I've been able to dig my roots into this tradition and these texts and finding that there's so much life still within them that so many of you are aware of and have been part of carrying these streams forward. So I feel indebted to both Bill and Dan for their questions, their stories, taking this thing so seriously, but not taking themselves too seriously within it. And I'm so grateful that I've been able to come to them for the comfort and challenge and conversation of what it means to try and to live out discipleship in this world. And I also appreciate the caution from Bill, I'll say as we go into the night, to resist the temptation to turn Dan into a moral cipher, asking what would Dan do, which I still kind of find myself doing anyway. But Bill says that that might distract us or even let us off the hook from answering the question that's actually each of ours to answer, which is, what am I to do? because even in these last 5 years since Dan's death, the world has changed so much. So as we find ourselves here going through this evening, immersing ourselves in the memories of Dan's life, hopefully we can keep letting all of these stories bring us back to our own and our own place within them and within these questions. So before I introduce Bill, I just want to make a note about the rest of the evening. We'll get to hear from a bunch of contributors to the book, a couple musical numbers, a slideshow, and then we'll have a couple toasts before the program closes around 9. But at that point, we'll take a little break and then invite anyone back who's interested to come and do some more toasts with a beverage of your choice. And all are welcome to contribute to a toast if you'd like to. We'll gather some names later for a cue. So, Bill Wylie-Kellermann, I think he hardly needs an introduction, but I am honored to introduce him anyway. He's a community activist, teacher, writer, pastor, and for 5 decades, he's been engaged in direct action and civil resistance to war and the structures of urban racialized violence. He was born in Detroit and has lived his whole life as a student of the city and its movements. He's the father of 2 amazing daughters, Lydia and Lucy, and partner to Denise, all of whom helped manifest this gathering this evening. And to me, Bill has been an incredibly dear and loving mentor. He has, I would say, is a part of the group of people that has ruined my life in the best of ways. And I thank him for that. He was first a friend and mentor of my dad's. Something's going on here. Is somebody sharing a screen, perhaps?
There we go. Now.
Okay, there we go. So Bill was first a friend and mentor of my dad's, and I'm lucky to have grown up with his name as sort of a household name. I was always like, he was sort of this ephemeral person, and I finally got to meet him and was just completely embraced with love and welcome, and have been learning from him ever since. So he has been a humble and powerful participant in these streams of resistance that Dan passed along to him, as well as many others of you that flow from and through the Gospels into our messy world today. So thank you so much, Bill, for weaving these stories together in this text and for gathering us here this evening.
Yeah, thank you. I'm so grateful to Kateri. She wrote an afterword to the book, but was really a collaborator in the whole process. One of my conversation partners in doing it, and I'm grateful for her co-hosting tonight. We're gonna kind of tag team. And I'm so thankful for all of you who are present tonight. Is a great storehouse of memory, love, conscience, community, word and deed. And we're gonna draw on it. It's 50 years ago this month that I graduated from college and headed by way of a summer in Baltimore to Union Theological Seminary in New York. And my second year there, Dan Berrigan arrived fresh from Danbury Prison, where he'd served time for the Catonsville Action to teach at Woodstock College, which was affiliated with Union. And the course of my life really hinges and turns on that year. He was teaching the book of Revelation, and the way that Dan read scripture really as a matter of life and death knocked me off my horse. I actually kind of freaked in and walked around barely able to speak for a while. It must have been obvious. Dan noticed and took me under his wing and engaged me in what I only learned to even identify later as a kind of spiritual direction. I want to read a birthday poem, which is at the beginning of the book, which I read for him 10 years ago today at his 90th birthday party on Thompson Street, and it begins the book. giving voice. The heart dares the word, dares the page. Less love stick in the throat of a pen and go untold. I remember my name in your voice, echoing down the underground hall beneath Niebuhr Place. Come, crack a jar of scotch. Come to talk and for a minted brew of tea. Come to life, awake, arise. And a scent follows, sweet and rash. Somehow that calling pipes through the Kentucky Hills retreat. While I still practice sport, before smoke rose from Detroit, your prayer with Merton and the circle breached the walls to fall also on me, summoning unbeknownst an answer. Later, in a season of crushing dark, you opened for me the gatehouse door, there to walk and breathe and eat the psaltery, to face dread dreams and heal. Confess a thing, even on this island now, the table talk of poet and keeper hatches the seminary renegade. That heady charismatic anarchy revives as we speak, and our once fresh formation turns, can it be, toward eldering? As you toward the body politic, body of word presented, burning with truth, the charnel house lies, this blood on pillars, a gash of vermilion, or hammering word at the door of church and state. In consequence, this bravery with a difference, the Holy Ghost gone militant, free in the cuff, in the dock, in the yard. For all, for missives kited in and out, for the discipline of hope, for drinking the moon underground, for writing on the wall against it, for bread in lotus fingers, all echoes in the heart at dusk, footfalls on the way, beloved, this thanks untellable. The poem references the 1964 Thomas Merton retreat and references it for its intercessions reaching forward, which I actually feel fell upon me and summoned my vocation. That retreat was so important. It's beneath both Catonsville and King of Prussia. It's beneath the draft board raids and the plowshares movement. But in the book, I found myself setting it in the context of the freedom struggle. Gordon Oyer's book on the retreat, The Spiritual Roots of Protest, revealed that Martin Luther King and Bayard Rustin were invited to that retreat and were eager to come. And what kept them away was that Dr. King received the Nobel Peace Prize, and the two of them went instead to Oslo to receive it. Dan founded the Clergy and Laity Concerned About Vietnam with Abraham Heschel, and Dr. King came to the organizing meeting for that in New York. And it actually turned into the platform at Riverside Church for Martin King's Breaking the Silence Beyond Vietnam speech of 1967, in which he, as a preacher, was not only speaking from the civil rights movement, but trying to pull the anti-war movement closer toward the freedom struggle. But I can't help imagining and reflected on it in the book, what it might have been for friendships and movement relationships to have been forged in the prayer of Gethsemane at that retreat. The poem also mentions Gethsemane as a healing place in my own geography. at a point where a really important community in my life and several marriages came apart. He sent me there, which turned out to be 6 weeks. And I really mention that as a reference to his pastoral care and pastoral gifts. I wrote this book in like 3 months. There were pieces I had in hand, but it kind of poured out of me. And some of it involved digging through old files or returning to dog-eared and underlined passages in books. But it was really more energetic and life-giving than that, more like, I don't know, like a surge of resurrection. Memories were released and kind of flowed out of me. I'd wake up in the morning fresh from dreams half remembered and just ready to write. And if I, in the afternoon, went for a walk on the block or to a lake or in the woods, I was immediately back at it, trying to keep up with myself on the page in a way of a book that I wrote about Jeannie Wiley's illness. Dan wrote that it was in some a signature of love. And I think that applies to this book as well. I do think about the vast store of memory that's represented in this large virtual room that we're in, which is a great storehouse, and we're only going to get to hear portions of it. After Dan's year with us at Union, I participated in the Tiger Cage Fast and Vigil in Washington, D.C. I wish I had time, but I don't, to tell how the Jonah House folk managed to get a model of a tiger cage, which is a variety of prison cell then being used in Vietnam for political prisoners, how they carried it up the Capitol steps and managed then for it to be kept there for the entire summer. And sitting in that model tiger cage and fasting, I memorized a long poem of Dan's, which he wrote from Danbury, the letter to Vietnamese prisoners, which is in the book. And in the center of it, there's a kind of parable which goes like this. We must remember, great Buddha said, the person, place, and time we first sat at table together, and the first generation remembered. The second generation forgot the time, but they remembered the house, and they sat with their brothers and sisters here or there, now or then, and great Buddha said, it is enough. The third generation forgot the hour and the house, but they sat with their brothers and sisters here or there, now or then, and great Buddha said, it is enough. The fourth generation forgot the hour, the house, and the faces of their brothers and sisters, and great Buddha wept. In the fifth generation, everyone was a stranger. Men and women were wounded and violated, tortured and outlawed, and great Buddha perished. He died a nameless peasant in the general conflagration, and he was buried in a common grave, and the earth was void. It's, in a way, it's the parable suggests that it's a memory that holds things together. In the parable, which is kind of a nightmare vision of that, the center seems not to hold, and things disintegrate in an outward spiral, a widening gyre, and the end is devastation because table fellowship and community and personhood and history has been forgotten. Dan spoke about the United States as the 50 states of amnesia, and that forgetting was the plague of our time. And that applied to how we remember events. He would say, today's news is tomorrow's cold omelet. And in this culture, to remember, to connect the dots, is actually an act of resistance. To remember to hold is to hold the center. This story's kind of I feel like it's an interfaith story. It's told to Buddhist prisoners, but I kind of sense in it a Passover meal. There's a little echo of Dayenu in the story, and certainly communion and Eucharist. I can picture him sitting with Thich Nhat Hanh in Paris and talking about Eucharist as remembering, membering again, putting the members of the body back together, making things whole. So tonight we remember Daniel, and we remember our friends in prison. We remember songs and jokes and stories. And we'll tell some history of conscience and when we sat at table together, the defense table, the kitchen table, and how we pass memory on to the next generation. The opening poem that I read says, I remember my name in your voice. And I'm actually pointing to my own call to discipleship. And there's something there about even remembering myself, who I am and called to be. And I kind of think how many countless folks on this sweet old planet did Dan do that for. Many, I think, many even in this room. Amen. Thanks be. To read, to introduce our next speaker, I'm going to read the dedication. So far we're 3 pages into the book here. For Claire Grady, indeed the greater Grady clan, with Elizabeth McAllister and all of the Kings Bay plowshares, for enacting like Daniel and Philip, their own hammer-rung witness of love. Ellen is Claire's sister and a member of the Greater Grady clan, which was widely known in Ithaca and beyond, parented by Teresa and John, longtime activists, John virtually an organizer of the draft board action movement. Ellen, committed plowshares participant. And Claire, who is currently in Alderson Federal Prison for the action at the Trident submarine base in Georgia. I lift her up in the dedication first, mostly for our personal conversations preceding the Kings Bay action, and for her pressing in those preparations Martin King's giant triplets of racism, militarism, and materialism to frame that April 4 action on his feast day. And Ellen's going to share some stuff, thoughts of her own, and some from Claire.
It's so beautiful to be here tonight with all of you. I told Bill I'm not the public speaker of the family. Other people are. You want me to organize something? I'll organize something. But anyway, I'm going to just read this briefly, and some of you, anyway, I'll read it and then you can. So before I begin my remarks, I think of Bill's words of remembering, and I'm thinking and calling to mind the Kings Bay Plowshares, who Bill referenced, Martha Hennessy, Patrick O'Neill, Carmen Trotta, and my sister Claire, as they're serving their time in four different prisons. And Steve Kelly, just out of prison after serving 3 years in mostly county jails, and who is not cooperating with the terms of probation, is now down by law, which is why we're not seeing him tonight here. And Mark Colville, who will be serving his sentence beginning on June 10th. And Liz McAllister, who after serving 18 months in the county jail is now living under 3 years of probation. It's good to remember them. Anyway, about a week and a half ago, I was speaking with Claire on the phone. We were checking in and trying to take care of some legal business. And that took a bit of our allotted 15 minutes of those prison phone calls. Then business out of the way, we quickly turned to family. How is everyone? How are the new babies born to Anna and Tom, Michael and Bella? How are each of our children, my grandchildren, nieces, nephews, sisters, and our brother John, who's been pretty sick with Lyme disease? The clock was ticking, and that's a lot of people to get through. But Claire said quickly at the end, oh, Ellen, you have to read Bill's new book. It's so beautiful, so much richness there, so much juiciness. And she said, read John and Lori, the last chapter about the priest on Claire Island, and read them Frida's forward. And then we were cut off. Our 15 minutes were up. So I spoke with Claire this morning. She was sorry not to be able to email me a written statement. She's challenged by the email technology there at Alderson, technology in general also, but she asked me to share how grateful she is to you, Bill, for taking the time to tell the story so that we can all be nurtured and encouraged by it. And so many of you may have heard my sister Teresa shared Claire's words last week on the DePaul Award ceremony, but I think her words are appropriate for tonight's gathering as well. Because as we're celebrating Dan's birthday, as well as this book, I always remember she starts it off with this poem. And I remember looking at it as a child and wondering what it meant. And anyway, you'll get to hear Claire's reflection. So here's begins. She says, we are here neatly as crystals. I can still see these words, the first words of a longer poem written by Dan, printed by him on a long piece of paper with an arch of colors painted with his hands, fingertips stretching from the top of the page to the bottom alongside the poem. Made while he was in Danbury prison, Dan gave it to our family. And like so many gifts from Dan throughout the years, each one became part of the family. Like relatives, they accompanied us, fed us, beckoned us. These words come to me now as I am serving my prison sentence in FPC Alderson. They come to me now because I am living and feeling the truth they carry. Thanks to Liz, Phil, and Dan, and so many elders, including my parents, Teresa and John, for showing by example that there is a geography to our faith. When we come together to undertake sacramental acts of symbolic disarmament, we realign our relationships with God, neighbor, and creation. As our geography shifts and we move towards trusting God more than idolatrous weapons, to loving God and neighbor and creation enough to disarm, we might find ourselves in federal prison a little more disarmed and humbled, calling on God for help. And we might see that we are exactly where we need to be, as women here say, quote, so that God can get closer to us, unquote. Then, God willing, we might feel how we are here, neatly as crystals, and give thanks. With love and gratitude, especially to you, Bill, tonight for this book, but for all those she already mentioned. Claire, thank you.
Thank you so much, Ellen, and all the Gradys, all around, wherever you all are. So before I introduce our next guest, I would like to point us to a little activity that we'll have going on throughout the evening. If you have the book, you can turn to page 13, but no worries if not yet. So this is just a brief little sort of fun Danism, I guess, that is, he used to end his many of his courses that he taught with very difficult final exams that were actually pretty much impossible to answer many of the questions. And he had sent Bill a copy of one once with a note assuring him that everyone had passed. There's a sampling in the book, and Dan says you can answer all, any, or none of the following questions. So I'll be putting a couple in the chat with each person that I introduce, and feel free to try to respond in your own heart or in the chat. So the first question that I'll ask is, reflect on the seven deadly sins. Describe how you have integrated these into your life. And so the next person, as you're thinking about that, I'm so excited to introduce Charlie King. He's a Massachusetts-based folk singer known to most everyone here, and he was a total celebrity name in my household. So this is very surreal getting to introduce Charlie King. His songs have been covered by many artists, among them Holly Near, Ronnie Gilbert, John McCutcheon, Arlo Guthrie, and Pete Seeger, who nominated him for the Sacco and Vanzetti Award, which he did indeed receive. He is famous for any number of movement songs and has agreed to sing us his On the Plowshares 8. Thank you, Charlie.
Thank you, Kateri. I bring with me the whiff of age, so be suspicious. My name is Daniel Berrigan, chaplain at a hospice for the dying. I have seen the face of death, it is for life I bring this hammer down. My name is Molly Rush, I have six children, they deserve a future. I strike this blow today for the children all the world around. I hear the prophet's cry of hope ring through the prison wall. We've waited 30 centuries to see that hammer fall. If we think we've got 30 more, we cannot see it all. Four swords into plowshares, the hammer has to fall. Dean Hammer is my name, Micah and Isaiah, my tradition. Oh, I tried to be their student, but could not resist their logic in the My name is John Shushard. I am no stranger to the prison that awaits us. But where genocide is legal, I stand an outlaw with a hammer in my hand. I hear the prophet's cry of hope ring through the prison wall. We've waited 30 centuries to see that hammer fall. We think we've got 30 more, we cannot see at all. Four swords into plowshare, the hammer has to fall. My name is Elmer Moss. Were this a peaceful world, I'd sit and play piano. But lacking Nero's conscience, I could not watch as the fire devoured the land. My name is Philip Berrigan. In World War II, I flew the bomber missions. But with every blow I strike today, I say the bombs will never fall again. I hear the prophet's cry of hope ring through the prison wall. We've waited 30 centuries to see that hammer fall. If we think we've got 30 more, we cannot see at all. For swords into plowshares, the hammer has to fall. Carl Cabot is my name, and I have lived and worked among the Third World people. I've seen corporations flourish while the poor were left to fight for every breath. My name is Anne Montgomery, my life spent in community with women. I bring their healing power to this factory of carnage and of death. I hear the prophet's cry of hope ring through the prison wall. We've waited 30 centuries to see that hammer fall. If we think we've got 30 more, we cannot see it all. Of swords into plowshares, the hammer has to fall.
Thank you, Charlie. To introduce the next speaker, I want to read a poem of Dan's called The Ring. I wear my mother's wedding ring, who lacked her voice, her smile. Carol gave it in my hand, last gift, first really, and only relic, lonely as we are. We are her post-mortem, altered. No, faith says post-vitam, I believe. I kiss it like a bridegroom and slip the narrow band on, which like her new existence has no north, south, east, west, but is like Saturn's ring, beyond and like gold unmined within. If it were a seashell, I could listen, but it rests there dumb. One thought I have, who never married, she wedded and conceived me and pushed me away into my own eventual responsibility. Then we buried her close in nature, and I inherit this golden pledge. I wish to be as well myself, woman too, and lonely as I am, and scarce half what I would be, must borrow from the dead and from little children that tenderness, awe, long loneliness, that are her planet's ring of light, our unmined gold. Frida Berrigan is the namesake of Frida Berrigan. Liz McAllister is her mother, and Philip, her father. She wrote a gorgeous and stunning foreword to Celebrant's Flame, as well as the book It Runs in the Family, on being raised by radicals and growing into rebellious motherhood. Frida Berrigan, a word from you.
Hello, everybody. Good to be with you. And happy Mother's Day to all your parents out there, biological and chosen, foster and grandparent. Mother's Day is an occasion to honor our mothers and to honor Mother Earth. It also causes me to reflect that on some level, motherhood is not, can't be bracketed by the biological feat of giving birth, but is embedded with a commitment to protect and nurture the next generation. And can we understand a mother as any person who says the seed corn must not be ground. The seed corn must not be ground. And in that broader definition of motherhood, Dan would fit nicely. He swam upstream against the sexism and the misogyny of his generation, of his gender, and of his faith institution. And he worked to protect and to nurture the seed corn. And that indelible image from the genius of the great German artist, Kath Kollwitz, is one of the many gifts that Dan has given to me. He took me to an exhibit of her work in the late 90s, I think, soon after I moved to New York City. And we stood in silence for so long in front of that drawing. The seed corn must not be ground. And I think too, in this broader definition of motherhood, someone like Sophie Scholl, who shares a birthday with Dan Berrigan, May 9th, 1921, as well. Thank you, Father Terry Moran, for pointing out that that whatever this is in words. Sophie Scholl, of course, was executed by the German state before her 22nd birthday. Never had the opportunity to be a mother, perhaps wouldn't have chosen it had she lived, and yet also holds that fervent need to protect the next generation, and stands, the seed corn must not be ground. This poem that Bill read, it's full of Dan's love for his mother, for Frida Fromhart. Nay Berrigan or Fromhart, Berrigan nay Fromhart, I think it goes that way, doesn't it? Full of his love for her and full of his identification with her sorrow and her loneliness. And it strikes me reading that poem and thinking about my own son, what a mature insight of a young boy it is to see the loneliness in his mother, right? And not, I don't think, the kind of thing that my son would notice about me. I feel sad for all of you, though, that you didn't get to see his interpretive dance while Charlie King was singing. It was, Lucy, he did you quite proud there. It was amazing. But anyway, Dan writes a lot about my grandmother's loneliness. And I think as he grew older, it mirrored his own loneliness in the sharp-elbowed company of Jesuits and hierarchs. And that loneliness was quite painful. And then there was the solace and solitude, the productive and healing loneliness that he needed as a contemplative. And an artist. Dan writes of his mother that she could be entrusted with the fate of the world. She could be entrusted with the fate of the world. He writes that in Portraits of Those I Love. And I think, the fate of the world certainly was in her hands as she created my dad and my uncles. So many of us, my sister, my brother, our children, owe our life to my grandmother, Frida. It's interesting how close attention Dan paid to women. He listened, he accompanied, he identified. He identified with women. And I'll just repeat this this sterling set of lines from the poem, The Ring. I wish to be as well myself, woman too, and lonely as I am and scarce half what I would be, must borrow from the dead and from little children that tenderness, awe, long loneliness that we, her planets, that are her planet's ring of light, our unmined gold. Going back to Portraits, Dan writes, I see her, my mother, as a kind of holy drudge, never quite broken, her gifts pressed hard, ground under, the lost chance, the bad luck she put on with her wedding ring, the sacrament, thou shalt not. And there she must stand, outside the circle. She could not take a stand. It had to be taken for her. Truly, possibly, it had been taken from her. And I know that Dan loved mothers and babies, and it was one of the great joys of my life to have babies in time, to have them know their Uncle Dan as they didn't know my father, their grandfather. And he delighted in children. He was able to be emotionally available and empathetic towards this very particular kind of cabin fever and frustration that afflicts mothers of small children. And his advice and his counsel was learned at his mother's knee. Bloom where you're planted. Bloom where you're planted. And that is the advice that I'm working still all these years later to integrate and try and write about that in Lydia's anthology on parenthood, Sandbox Rebellion. The funny thing about that piece of advice, bloom where you're planted, is that Dan never directly gave me that advice. It was given to me by mothers a generation and even two generations older than me that Dan had given them. And so when I went with my cabin fever frustrations to other women, they said, "Well, you know what your uncle told me." And I said, "No, please tell me." And the advice was, bloom where you're planted, do what you can. And it strikes me that that was my grandmother, you know, bloomed where she was planted in the thin, hard soil of outer Syracuse. The only woman among six boys and a very tough customer for a husband. So bloom where you're planted, live and act and work on a human scale. Start small, stay small, resist Americanization, the bloating, franchising, and outsourcing that counts for success these days. And it occurs to me that my grandmother's life and her memory helped my Uncle Dan with the discipline of modesty and ego checking. I think whenever he got, you know, a little kind of high on his own sauce, he was able to return to the steady discipline of Frida, my grandmother. You guys should see my notes. They're really pretty terrible. But I guess I want to say two more brief things. And one is that I wear this narrow band that Dan wrote about now. Carla, who's Carol Berrigan's daughter, gave it to me when Dan died. And it's my only remembrance of a woman who died when I was still a toddler, right? It's the only object I have to remember her. And yet it's, you know, because it's right here, you know, it is with me always, and it's a huge comfort and inspiration and sort of grounding for me. So that was the second to last thing that I wanted to say. And the final thing I want to say is to offer greetings and gratitude from my own mother, from Elizabeth McAllister, to whom the Celebrant Flame is dedicated along with Claire and the Kings Bay Plowshares. She is, as many of you know, in New London, living with my sister Kate and her partner Karen, just up the road from our family here. And as Ellen said, she's about a year into 3 years of supervised probation. Sorry to be missing this gathering tonight, but you know, we had sort of an epic Mother's Day brunch this afternoon, and sort of out of her capacity to stay up this late. I'm really pleased to be with all of you to celebrate Dan with all of you, to celebrate this book with all of you, and to remember Dan Berrigan. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Frida. Such a beautiful gift to get to hear from you and all of these stories of your family ancestry that you carry with you into this space. So the next question from our little Dan quiz is, has the church always taught anything? Be specific. And I'll put that in chat. Please feel free to chime in. And now for our next speaker, I'm really pleased to introduce Jim Reale, who's a Plowshares activist and one of the filmmakers who recently produced The Berrigans, Devout and Dangerous, which many have seen just this week. He was a resident of Block Island, and it was in that connection that he first met Dan through William Stringfellow. I'm aware that it was right around when he was my age. And he has a letter included in Celebrant's Flame, and we'll get to hear a brief excerpt of that tonight. So over to you, Jim. Thank you.
Thank you. Just a little background here. I moved in with Bill Stringfellow. And so you just need to know that, and this will make sense. On a bright sunny day, the following month, I came home from my job laboring for a mason, exhausted and covered with cement dust. A stranger opened the door and said, "Welcome, hand extended." I thought to myself, "I live here, and who are you?" It was Daniel Berrigan, come to visit to see how Stringfellow was faring. The three of us had dinner for several evenings. They were talking politics and theology, while I was primarily focused on the chow, scratching my head and debating if I should leave after dinner and go to the local watering hole to shoot some eight ball. I was still working on my long rail bank shot. One may be tempted to assume that Dan Berrigan was amassing an army of anti-war activists to carry out his vision of peace through civil disobedience. Not so. He wasn't a recruiter for any cause, however needed or noble, nor was he fixed on making his purpose your purpose. More accurate to say, he was a Pied Piper for peace and disarmament. You either heard his music or you didn't. It was more his conviction rather than any effort to convince you that created a turning of one's life in a direction other than self. He was able to focus on an individual, much like a teacher from the East mentors a student, with great care and deep understanding of the qualities and abilities unique to the person in front of him. This is the side of Daniel Berrigan, not known publicly. His wise contemplative heart, woven with love for God, people, and earth. Never could I have predicted how the stranger at my door some 38 years ago would have changed my life in ways unimaginable. I saw Dan 3 days before his last Christmas at Maury Weigel Hall in the Bronx. He was nearly nonverbal, and it would be only a few short months before his death. He sat in his wheelchair while I, on bent knee before him, clasped his hands, looking downward and inward with a monastic silence. We entered a contemplative state that I shall never forget. And so I dare to say, if you have met Daniel Berrigan, you have met Christ, because Christ lives within him. I am reminded of a yoga master, TKB Deskachar, in Chennai, India, who I met and studied with. And he said, a teacher takes the hand, opens the mind, and most importantly, touches the heart. This is what Dan did for me and so many others. Hear, hear, Daniel Berrigan, happy birthday.
Thanks, Jimmy. Is Dylan McConus on? She's the
Hi.
Oh, there she is. Yay. Yeah, I just, I'll introduce her quickly here. Dylan McConis is a graphic novelist and a gifted artist who did the wonderful iconographic portrait of Dan, which has become the cover of the book. I stumbled on it when I was searching for photos of him and immediately ordered the poster size version. It comes in cards as well. And it turns out to have a story which I've asked her to tell. Dylan.
Yeah, not every cartoonist has produced an intensely personal portrait of Daniel Berrigan for their website. He surprised me. Oh, that's my own seed corn in the background. It's her dinner time, so I apologize if there are occasional yelps from her direction. I originally created this portrait of Father Berrigan for my own father, Charlie McConis, in recognition of Father Berrigan's death about a year afterwards. I made it for him. Like a lot of the people in this meeting, I was raised under unusual circumstances. My father also used to be a father. He was a Catholic priest, and he held Dan to be his mentor. And indeed, they went on many adventures together. There's a reason why my parents' Wi-Fi password is my dad's federal prison number. And Dan's prison booking photos were up with the family portraits on the wall. So I always felt that he was a member of the family, even though I was raised in Seattle, 3,000 miles away. True to his nature, when I was a teenager and looking at colleges, including Columbia, my father brought me to New York to look at a few campuses, and Dan invited us out to lunch to a lovely vegetarian restaurant, of course, and had a wonderful time. So I, as a teenager, just got to casually meet this this titan of the movement. And his death was obviously a huge moment of spiritual impact for my father. So I wanted to create a portrait just in recognition of that for him and of the importance of acting in the place of an Old Testament prophet in a dark time in our collective history. And of course, Jeremiah was the one who came to mind for me. I know we all have our favorite Old Testament prophets. But that one was a personal favorite. And looking at the iconography for him, finding that he's virtually always depicted with a scroll of his own prophesying. And I felt that was a beautiful match for some of the most famous photographs of Dan. So I merged the two together, and I used an excerpt from Tulips in the Prison Yard. My own father's experience in prison involved a great deal of taking pleasure and solace in those tiny bits of nature of life and hope that came through. And on his own release, deciding to marry my mom, deciding to have a child as an act of defiance and hope, was all very much in keeping with his relationship to Dan and Dan's theology. So creating that portrait, including the handcuff peace sign, it was a real honor to create. And it was even more of an honor to receive a random piece of email in my inbox saying, "Thank you for this lovely portrait. By the way, you wouldn't happen to be related to Charlie McConis just by any random chance?" Yes, very closely related. And Bill and I began a wonderful correspondence that was only moderately interrupted by a pandemic, by me having a baby, all the bits and pieces of life, but being able to repurpose this art for such a remarkable project and yet another commemoration of an incredible life was a real honor. I'm so grateful that we found each other and were able to connect, and that this this small icon of a great icon could have a second life in your work.
Thanks, Dylan. I would only add two quick things. Charlie was actually in our class with Dan. He was a student at Woodstock, and he wrote a book called With Clumsy Grace, which some of you may know, which is a history of the Catholic left, basically the draft board raids. And then lastly, the poem that that Dan is holding in the icon, he hand lettered on our wall in Battle Creek. So I knew it by heart when I saw it. So thank you. I don't even know how to begin to introduce, am I still on? Okay, good. I don't even know how to begin to introduce Kathy Kelly. She's an international peace activist out of the Catholic worker tradition. She's been arrested many times, organizes international interventions, found herself beneath the US bombs, witnessing shock and awe. With regard to Celebrant's Flame, she and I had, actually before I launched into the book, she and I had begun a correspondence about the Albert Camus plague chapter, which wasn't a chapter then, before it turned into a conversation with Dan Berrigan. And that correspondence led to her letter in the book, for which I'm very grateful, and offer now the floor to her. Kathy Kelly.
Oh, it's so lovely to be in this group. Thank you very, very much. That flame is burning. So in 1991, I was part of a peace team, which was kind of parked in a remote desert in Iraq, fairly close to the Iraq-Saudi border. And we were called the Gulf Peace Team. It was January 1991. And it sounds kind of like La La Land, but we had come to interpose ourselves between the warring parties, between the United States forces and Saddam Hussein's forces. And you know, it was getting more and more serious. We expected the war to begin any day. And I had arrived with one of the last contingents for this camp, coming mainly from the United States. Others were already there from India, from Australia, from the United Kingdom, from Belgium, Germany, New Zealand. And you could kind of ask, well, what led 70 people from 18 different countries to park themselves in the desert to interpose themselves between warring parties? And so with the new group having just arrived, many introductions happened in large groups and in small groups. And I was amazed because so many of the people spoke of Dan or quoted Dan or said what they knew of Dan to try to help make sense of their own reality just at that moment. And now two people, one of whom is on the call, Kathy Boylan and Anne Montgomery, were people who knew Dan so, so well, and they were seasoned plowshares activists. But most of the people there had never met Dan. But nevertheless, they spoke repeatedly about being influenced by Dan's assertion that one of the reasons we don't have peace is because people only give half of their lives for peace, and soldiers are called upon to give their entire lives, possibly risk losing their lives, to stop a war. So Dan's question just pushed the envelope. Do peace activists trying to prevent war expect as much of themselves? And so there we were, people who had volunteered to join the Gulf Peace Team. And I believe so many had gotten Dan's message and then shared his message to try to explain to their loved ones, what are you doing there? So Dan's words crossed borders, and people who might not always have understood political angles could understand his lyrics, his symbols, and it translated very well. I want to say it helped me out quite a bit. I was, to say the least, a complete unknown in that camp. And when we introduced ourselves, what could I say? Well, I'm a tax deadbeat and an ex-con. You could forgive other people in the Gulf Peace Team who might have wondered, you know, is this the best the US recruiters could come up with when they sent people to join this illustrious team? But because of Dan, really, I could get some street cred. People would actually sort of look at someone like me and say, you're one of them. You're one of his. And I felt so happy to be claimed. And I think that feeling is widely shared by all the people in this call tonight. You're one of his. And that's certainly a good reason to toast Bill's book and to toast Dan's wonderful life. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kathy. I remember a couple of years ago, I heard you speak and you said, someone asked you what your plan for retirement was, which is such an odd question. And you said, befriending young Catholic workers. That's really stuck with me. So if you ever want to come to Detroit, you're always welcome here. So our next question from the exam is there such thing as a theologically indefensible position? Explain. Would love to hear. And the next person that I have the pleasure of introducing is Father John Deere, who was a member of the Pax Christi Spirit of Life Plowshares and has published many books on Jesus and gospel nonviolence. He was a longtime friend of Daniel Berrigan and has become his literary executor and head of the Daniel Berrigan Literary Trust. He was a big supporter of Celebrant's flame in the writing, and we're really grateful that he's here tonight.
Thank you very much, Kateri, and thank you, everybody. Thank you, Kathy. Bill, thank you so much for the beautiful book. I had was putting together a new book of Dan's poems, his most political and prison poems and so forth. So I called Bill in November and said, I don't know if you remember that. I said, Bill, I'm so sorry, but you have to write an introduction. And he calls me back a week later and said, well, I'm writing a book instead. So it's what happened, and it's just fantastic. I don't know how you did it so fast, but thanks for bringing us all together. It's been a hard day for me, actually. I didn't expect that. I've been working on this birthday for a while. I wrote a long remembrance of Dan, which is online, and I did a 3-hour Zoom yesterday teaching about him, and I recorded a podcast about him and so forth. But I've been home reading his books and poems and thinking about him, and there's just so many thoughts. I was in community with him for 35 years and lived with him for many years and traveled the country and Europe with him. We have a million friends. My friend Jack Morris, I think, is on, or was on, or might still be on. But when I was in prison with Phil, I was thinking how Merton never had a party. No one ever celebrated his life. And in certain ways, Dorothy Day didn't either. And so when I got out, I called Jack and said, we have to organize a big event for Dan's 75th birthday. A couple of you were there. It was 1996, 1,000 people came. Pete Seeger gave an incredible performance, and Allen Ginsberg, who said to me, I have no desire to be there except for Dan. And after 10 minutes, he said, this is great. And by the end, he wouldn't leave and said it was one of the greatest nights of his life. It was a great evening. I think you might agree, Bill, if you remember that, and others who were there. Dan hated it. For those of you who knew him personally, and I made him do this, you know, as a gift for the movement. I said, I don't care about your birthday. we have to bring people together to give people hope. And I spent a fortune on a professional photographer to take 500 pictures of the evening with Liam Neeson and all these wonderful people. a book for Dan and one for me. And every photo of Dan, he's unhappy. So I thought, well, I'm not doing that again. And a year goes by and he says to me one night, well, that was the greatest party ever. What are you planning for my 80th birthday? And thus began a tradition, if some of you remember, we had Mac and I pulled out this other big event with 1,000 people. And then one for the 85th birthday and another 1,000 people. And it was just an incredible experience. And he was so happy. And I hope he's thinking about us having a party on his 100th birthday as well, my point. Remember at one of the parties, Kurt Vonnegut stood up and said, it was so beautiful. For me, Daniel Berrigan is Jesus as a poet. And we all love that. But so thanks, Jack, for all that hard work. And I think that I was in community with him for all those years, and we had a very special community on the Upper West Side at 98th Street, which was really founded by Dan. And we were together all the time. And it was a weird community because no one didn't want to not be with them. I don't know if that came out right, but we were together all the time, and then we would all go away on our annual retreat to be together. No Jesuit community in the country or the world did that. And that was because of Dan. He was just so much fun to be with behind the scenes. And there was just a lot of laughs and beautiful reflections and poetry and masses and sharings of our lives day to day, which were very, very rich. And the arrests I was thinking about today, I don't know if this is okay, Bill, what I'm saying here. I'm just reflecting informally with you. We were arrested every 3 months in New York City for, 30 years through Kairos. And you go, well, that's really nice. We went down to Riverside Research, we sang, we did something, and they put us in jail for the day and then released us, and we all had a party. But there were moments that were terrible, really, really terrible. And I'll tell one of them. And it was around, I think it was Martin Luther King Day. I have it somewhere in my notes in 2000. We were arrested at the USS Intrepid, let's say at 11 o'clock in the morning, maybe 10 of us. It's a small action. It was just a way of life. But all the jails in all of the five boroughs were full. And they couldn't take anybody. It was me, Dan, Carmen, Simon Herrick, the Jesuit who's now dead, and one other friend who I can't remember. And we were chained together in our ankles and our waists and our hands and kept in a van till midnight. We were together for 12 hours and couldn't move. And it was probably in the 20s, but we didn't really dress that warmly because we weren't thinking we were gonna be there. Yes, I know, Jack, there are others, Ann, thanks for that one. Anyway, the story was, it was freezing cold and we were brought to the tombs, but they didn't even have a place to park us. So they parked us a good 10 blocks away, city blocks away. We had 25 armed police around the five of us men who were chained together and I was behind Dan. And we were freezing, we hadn't eaten. And it was awful. He wrote a poem about it, which is gonna be in the new book called Payment. And he just thought that was like his entrance fee into heaven. But I was walking behind him and it was a kind of Jesus carrying the cross moment. I don't mean to be over melodramatic, but he suffered like he did in prison in so many ways. And I'm just sharing that, one of many memories. A year after Dan died, we were invited, Liz McAllister, Robert Ellsberg, and I, to speak in the big theology school in San Antonio by this great guy, Father Ron Rollheiser. And he was reading all Dan's books. I don't know if you all saw this book, Testimony, that I did of Dan's later essays, which is really one of his best books. And Ron hadn't read it before, but he did it to get ready for the weekend on Dan. And he thought the most profound thing that Dan had ever said, and this is what I want to share with you, was from his Plowshare sentencing in April 1990. It's very interesting, only in this book. I don't know if you all remember it. It was in the New York Times. Dan is talking, so he's waited 10 years for the sentencing. Remember, it's 1990. He's expecting 10 years in prison. He went there expecting to go to prison. And he gave this incredible statement in court where basically he's talking about our action and what we did and what we were trying to say. And this reminds me of another person 2000 years ago who stood before a judge and was unarmed and nonviolent and trying to bring peace to the world. And then if you listen carefully, you're not sure what he's saying, but he's no longer addressing the judge. He's addressing Jesus in a sentencing statement. Do you see? He's very subtle, and it becomes a prayer. And I think went over everybody's head, in my opinion. I've been studying it. Ron is the one who's pointed this out. I invite you to reflect on it. The last few lines are like this. For the plowshares eight, our judgment is in better hands than our judges. In the hands, let us pray, of a holy defendant once reviled and misnamed in an earthly court, named and finally nailed in infamy. His wounds, we believe, are healed and glorious. And his name is above every name, every earthly power and dominion, including the power and dominion of this court or of any earthly court. It is to him, finally, we proffer our argument. He's standing before the judge, and he's addressing Jesus, not the judge. The argument goes this way: if the children of the world will be accounted safer for our imprisonment, so be it, we go in a good spirit. If the earth will be accounted free of nuclear illness and insult for our imprisonment, so be it, we go in a good spirit. If first strike weaponry is to be judged within the law and we outside the law, so be it, we go to prison in a good spirit. I think that is such a holy statement, and it's like the martyrs of the early church. And I always felt this from the minute I met Dan, that I was with St. Paul and St. Peter, that or some of those early martyrs who said spectacular things in court like that. Can I tell one more story, Bill? No? Okay. Should I wrap it up, Lucy? Okay. Well, I'll tell one more story then. About 10 years before he died, we were walking on the beach in Block Island. And he told me, I just got this letter from the Bishop of Montana. And this is one of the most right-wing Catholic bishops in the world. Okay? Dear Father Berrigan, I'm so-and-so. And I'm writing to you because I have been counseling this woman in the diocese who's been having apparitions of Our Lady Mary for the last 2 years, once a month, and I believe her. Well, last week she came in to see me and was telling me what Mary said. This is very true story. Mary was crying to this lady, this visionary, about the state of the church and the world and the fact that there's so few good priests and ministers and religious servants. Mary was just broken up. And the lady says to Mary of Nazareth, isn't there one person, one good priest on the planet? To which Mary said, well, my son really likes Father Daniel Berrigan. I don't know if I told you that story. I later interpreted that to mean like Mary was saying, can you believe it? Jesus likes Dan. You know, like she's a little disappointed of all these. Anyway, it was a great story for me and for Dan. And that's the first time I've told this. One of a million stories I haven't told about Dan, who was, I'm sure, greatly loved by Jesus and the saints and by thousands of great people and by all of you. Thanks so much for celebrating his life. And let's honor him by continuing to make peace and practice nonviolence and teach nonviolence and resurrection for the rest of our lives, just as Dan taught us. But thanks, Bill.
Thank you, Jen. The other person who was, another person who was really helpful in the preparation and writing of the book is Father Terry Moran, who's on with us. He was an enormous help, tempering my assumptions and easy errors as a Protestant sometimes. He was also a close friend of Dan's, a member of the Kairos community, and a keeper of a wonderful assortment of photographs, which he freely shares periodically and in various ways. And he put a few of them together for us this evening. And I want to invite him to share a few words in introducing him. Kateri?
Thanks, Bill. As all of you can well imagine, it was no easy task to put together the life of Dan Berrigan, close to 95 incredible years in 3 minutes. You'll recognize the music behind the PowerPoint as the theme from The Mission, a beautiful piece of music by Ennio Morricone. It's a film in which you all know Dan appeared, and he had one line, the word no. And I don't know if the director knew the significance of that, because if Dan taught anything, it was that our yeses in life don't count for all that much unless they're accompanied by an active and resisting no to anything, to any force that would cheapen or demean or oh so casually snuff out a human life. At the end of that beautiful film, The Berrigans, Devout and Dangerous, that have been mentioned several times tonight, Frida tells a beautiful story that Dan told her, that when he would walk through the crowded streets of New York, the pedestrians coming at him, he would pray looking at their faces as so many beads of a rosary and contemplate in them all the great mysteries of life. So I invite you in that same spirit to look at a few images of Dan's life and to contemplate the joyful, sorrowful, and glorious mysteries of the life of Daniel Berrigan.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Kateri. That was really wonderful. Putting this together this evening, I've had kind of a dream team of my daughter, Lucy Wylie-Eggert, who's an artist and designer and social media person, and she's on the computer. She's part of a collective that does movement media called Three Lions Creative, and Lydia Wylie-Kellermann, my other daughter, older daughter, has been the organizer along with Denise and Kateri for this thing. But then the other person I want to bring in here is Heidi Thompson, who I've just had a great joy of being able to work with and meet with regularly. She's an independent marketing specialist in Washington, D.C., who was formerly on the staff of Sojourners Magazine. And it's just been really great to work with her. Until now, I didn't realize that I'd never even tried to hustle one of my books before. And getting the word out about it, she's been an enormous help. And she's here actually to hustle the book. So, Heidi.
Thanks, Bill. I just wanted to take a moment tonight to tell all of you how you can get your own copy of Celebrant's Frame if you don't have one already. You can, of course, go to your favorite independent bookseller and they'll be able to get it for you. Or if you'd like to order online, you can go to Bill's website and we'll put the link to his website in the chat. And if you sign up for Bill's email list, where you can find out about other projects that he'll be working on, we'll send you a coupon for 25% off at WIP and Stock, and you can buy it directly from the publisher for 25% off. So that's a great deal, and it won't be around for very long. We only have it for a few more days. So these will make great Father's Day presents. They'll make great graduation presents for young people, or just a gift for someone who you think is going to be inspired and encouraged by Father Dan's challenge of the church and his life for changing the world. So it's been my joy to work with Bill on this project, and I just encourage you to support this book. If we want stories like this to be told, we have to support the writers and the publishers who are bringing those stories to us. And this is a chance to do that. Thanks, Bill.
Thank you so much. So we get to start moving into our toast section of evening tonight. And if you would like to, you can start putting your names in the chat to sort of get on a queue for the toasting. We do have a few that we already have lined up. And to start, I'm really pleased to introduce Eric Martin, who teaches in the UCLA Center for the Study of Religion, and with Dan Kosachi, oh no, I didn't get that name, but maybe Eric can correct us. They edited the Berrigan Letters, which is the correspondence between Dan and Phil, and Bill acknowledges a big debt to him for his remarkable dissertation, which is called A Theology of Disobedience, The Conversion of Daniel Berrigan, 1953 to 1966. I really appreciated that in Eric's piece in Celebrant's Flame. He jokes that Dan repeatedly...
Did we lose her?
I think we might have. I'm happy just...
Word to you, Eric.
Yeah, we missed a lot of what you said, Kateri, but... Not a lot, but
oh no,
the last little bit. I'll be quiet.
Sorry about that.
I'm happy just going with it. Don't worry.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, so I get to choose the book and do a toast to it. So this book, the first time I heard about it, Bill called me on the phone and said, what I heard was, I'm going to do a book called Celibate Flame, which I thought sounded pretty cool, frankly. And maybe that could be your next book, Bill. Sounds like a steamy non-romance or something, but I want to toast this book, and I hope someday we can toast that book. So yeah, I don't know, just three very quick toasts. A toast to the fact that this book is very spacious. You're a humble author, and there's a lot of space for other people to have their voices. You know, it starts with Frida quoting Phil, quoting Dr. King. At the end, you have Kateri quoting Grace Ahern about reading Dan while, quote, topless and tipsy on a queer beach in Queens. And it just goes to all sorts of corners that it wouldn't go to if it had an author that wanted to hog all the space. So I just really respect that. So cheers to that. And I just really liked what Rosemary Berger called the mycelium of friendship at the very first page of this book that's on there. I didn't know what that meant, Rose, but I looked it up and I agree with you that it rests at the center of this. And I think it's fitting for a book on Dan. And Anna Brown called it, she said, it breathed life in her bones, this book. And as someone who I think really carries on a lot of the Berrigan spirit, I don't know, I agree. So the second toast, Bill wanted me to share a story about me and Dan. I don't know how interesting they are, and I know we're going a little long, so I might just summarize it and say the stories aren't all that exciting. I was kind of an annoying young guy who was kind of just saying, Dad, don't go to sleep, Dan. You gotta tell me more about prayer and conscience and community and stuff, which isn't all that exciting. But I will just say at the funeral, he introduced me to the Catholic Worker. And the funeral, I remember singing with Art Laffin. There was something very circular. It was as if Dan gifted a whole community, the whole DC Catholic Worker community, Kathy Boyle and Colleen and Mike. They changed my life, and that was a gift from Dan. And when I was leaving the funeral, I bumped into a woman named Sue Frankelstripe. And I was about to move to Charlottesville, and she lived there. And so it was like he was gifting community from the coffin. So that's a quick story about Dan. But the final toast is to this book's stories. Kateri, in the end of the book, you said that Dan's life is a gospel study in and of itself, which I really liked. And the book really reads like it's like a gospel according to Brother Berrigan, according to Brother Bill, I guess, you know. And just to share one very quick story he tells, that Bill tells in this book, is about Dan encountering people who were very down and out and just kind of burnt out. And in Bill's words, Dan would share, don't be a conscious integer in the empire's spiritual body count. And now he's quoting Dan. Don't die, Dan told someone withering away in despair. We need you. The guy rose and filled with life, even poetry. He joined actions of nonviolent resistance. And I just love all these little stories, Bill, that you put in there, kind of capturing like little resurrections, I guess, to riff on Frida's phrase, like little biblical healing. So Kathy Kelly says to count on your readers, Bill, to store your stories. And I really like that. So cheers to this book. I love it. Thank you for it. It's really good.
Thank you, Eric. I'm so grateful for, he's virtually a collaborator on the chapter about the Dan and Phil and the freedom struggle. I stole it right out of his dissertation, which I hope people get to read at some point. The other toast we have is from John Bach, who John was draft resistance prisoner with Dan at Danbury. He wrote a letter in the for the book about the great books class that Dan and Phil taught at Danbury and what a transforming thing that was. And he was really the first in the process of writing a letter to me that got included in Celebrant's Flame, and in a way it seeded the others and turned the book into a little more of a community work. He once hitchhiked to Detroit from Connecticut, actually many times as I think about it, but I'm thinking of the time he hitched for Jeannie Wylie and my wedding to give the toast, which was epic, and for which reason and others, I can't begin to think of a better person to begin the toasting with a toast of Dan than John Bach.
Oh, Bill, how do I love thee? Let me count the name with the ways. Nay, they're innumerable. Has it really been almost 5 decades since we've been trotting these long furrows together? I'm John Bach, he, him, his. I'm tuning in from Arlington, Cambridge, the home of the Wampanoag and the Massachusetts people. All due honor. I did time with Phil and Dan. At that time, I witnessed and took part in the greatest miracle I have ever seen, which was getting a bunch of guys in a totally self-centered universe to figure out that freedom had very little to do with what side of the prison wall you were standing on. Truly a miracle. When I was thinking about this toast, I thought I just couldn't do it. And why wouldn't I let Dan himself propose the toast? Ah, you may think, no mean feat, but easier than you might also think, and that'll be coming up. But first, a little background. Bill said this was okay, and I've timed myself. I will not go over my heroic 4 minutes. After Dan got out of prison, he sent out a fundraising letter, and it was entitled Radical Cheek, C-H-E-E-K. This was a ripoff of Tom Wolfe's essay, Radical Chic, C-H-I-C, that chronicled the clash of cultures when liberal, very, very wealthy public figures, mostly actors and actresses, hosted fundraising events for the Black Panthers in Upper East Side, extremely wealthy condos, or in mansions in Hollywood. Radical Chic. Dan's Radical Cheek, something different. His hustle was for a donation, he would travel to your house, and when you provided the scaffolding or ladder, he would write a poem on your wall. This is what Bill referenced, and the poem that Bill's community home got is on the cover of the book. The Whale's Tale in Hartford got, luckily, Dan's retelling of Psalm 126, which eventually appeared in his book, Uncommon Prayer, in which he retold a number of this psalm. Psalm 126 is all about liberation in captivity and where real freedom is. The fundraiser was a total bust. I don't think he probably covered subway tokens, but a lot of us did wind up with really, really great poems. So I'm going to recite Dan's retelling of that, only putting Dan into the middle of it, and it works. How many of us can say that Dan contributed to our marrow in our bones deep understanding of where freedom really is in the creation, the sustenance, and the nutrition of our beloved community? We had high ceilings, probably 15 feet. We had to drag the dining room table over to the wall. Dan got up on it. He cleared his throat. We came in, we put a stepladder where the table had been. And he wrote this in his wonderful artistic calligraphy, right? And underneath there was plenty of room. And he suggested that visitors write the names in their own handwriting of all political prisoners that they knew of. So we have Dan's retelling of Psalm 126, underneath which there was just a surplus, a wonderful surplus of political prisoners from all over the world. There was also the perfect, in the manner of a Zen koan, poem that Dan wrote for the wedding of Phil and Liz. Here it is. It was always, never again, to be safe, summed up our lives. So the original psalmist in this psalm used the word Lord. Dan in the retelling used the word spirit. And here it is. When Daniel Berrigan's spirit set us free, we could scarcely imagine it for all the joy we felt. Were we free? Were we wrapped in a dream of freedom, our mouths filled with laughter, our tongues with pure joy. The oppressors were awestruck. What marvels this priest works for them. Like a torrent in flood, our people streamed out. Locks, bars, cages, gulags, ghettos, Dan scattered the nightmare. We trod those long furrows, slaves, sowing in tears. Dan provided the lightning bolt that loosed us. And now we tread these same furrows, staggering, half drunk with joy, the golden sheaves in our arms. Dan put those golden sheaves in our arms and telling us and enabling us and walking with us out of captivity into liberation of our own making. Bill, thank you for the book. All of you for your presence in the beloved community. My utmost gratitude and thank you. Is it now time to raise a glass? What do you think, Bill? That wasn't too bad, was it?
You're still my favorite toaster.
Thank you, John. Thank you, everyone. So we are now wrapping up the official program, and we are going to take a little bit of a break right now. So if folks are interested in sticking around, you're welcome to take a little bathroom break if you'd like, or maybe grab something for more toasts if you want to hang out with us, or feel free to go about your night and leave with all of our wishes. And we'll be on the break, we'll be listening to the song I Have No Right by Dar Williams, which is about Daniel Berrigan. Thank you all so much for being with us.
God of the poor man, this is how the day began. A co-defendant sighed, Daniel Berrigan. Oh, and only a layman's batch of napalm. We pulled the draft files out, we burned them in the parking lot. Better the files than the bodies of children. They had no right before the love of you. Drop their bombs right where my government knew I would be. I had no right before the love of you. I had no right before the love of you. And all my country saw
love of you and every
Okay, now we're down to an intimate 77 participants.
And Eric Martin is my second favorite toaster.
Yeah.
Okay. So
So far.
I'm very excited to introduce Grace, who played a really big part in my afterword, and I was really grateful to feature a good chunk of her words, actually, that she had written for G's Magazine's issue on powers and principalities for an article titled, Do I Want to Inherit This Theology? And that was the add in Tipless and Hopsy, topless and tipsy in on a beach in Queens that Eric mentioned. So Grace is a queer Southern Asian American and proud seminary dropout. And she says that she communicates with white people for a living, which is through her work with Surge. God bless you in that work, Grace. And she lives in Charlottesville and is married to a remarkable queer. So I'll pass it over to you, Grace. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Kateri. Hey, everyone. good to be with y'all. Just in that moment, as you're reading my little intro, Kateri, I went to run and get a different teacup, which I'll get to in my toast. But I was like, I'm going to use my little gay teacup as I'm toasting Dan Berrigan. just to honor him in that. So as Kateri said, I wrote this article in G's kind of processing my relationship to a lot of these white male theologians who have been coming in and out of my legacy as a Christian leftist. This toast is just a little kind of summing up of that and where I'm at processing it now. Like many of y'all, I walked the earth briefly with Dan, but never actually got to meet him in person. I never sat at his feet and asked him if everything was gonna be okay. I can imagine him like rolling his eyes at me, like live tweeting from different actions that are happening. As far as getting to know him goes, I only know the things that my friends have told me and the things that I've read about him. And for a lot of years in my early 20s, I was really reckoning with this monumental grief and rage of living in this world that wasn't shaped for me. And I went through a healthy period of feeling betrayed and cynical towards these sainted social justice men of legend. You know, I just had my years of saying, fuck you, Dan Berrigan, and your little monk bros too, in my early 20s anger. But in the turning away, I nursed those wounds and got stronger by drinking from the wellspring of the radical presence of Black women, queer people, and mothers. So today, Dan, on your 100th birthday, I celebrate that I have made my way back to you in my 30s. It happened over the last few years, at first mainly because a lot of the people that you loved I also love, and it felt kind of rude not to trust them. But these folks were teaching me that you were drinking from those same waters too that I was, that were healing me, and they were shaping and healing you too. Today, Dan, I welcome you as my ancestor, this white man, Catholic priest, who represents so many of the things that have harmed me, but who also represents an imperfect and in process possibility of how we heal and grow and keep moving and return to one another. I know that there are many people in the world who are not worth the effort of returning to, but there are also some that are. My prayer for our movements, your legacy of movement, Stan, is that we know how to discern the difference and that we keep growing the skills that it takes to stay with those who are worth the struggle. After all, we're all headed in the damnedest direction without any roadmap except that of good friends, which you wrote your brother once in a letter, and good friends and chosen ancestors too. Cheers to you, Dan, the ancestor who I struggled for and who was worth the struggle.
Damn, cheers, Grace, and all, thank you. Next up, I'll pass it over to Denise, and then on deck we have Jerry.
Great. Hi, everybody. Really, what a great night. thank you for everybody's part in this tonight. So when I got asked to do a toast, I was thinking, who do I toast? How do I do this? And then I thought, I just want to toast my husband, Bill. And so I lift my glass and my heart to you, Bill, the author of Celebrant's Flame. I toast the joy of this book, the joy that is kindled in your heart and in your life and in our life together. I toast the way that the stories tumbled out of you and so many others, and how you knew which ones were the ones that had to find a way into the book and that had to find a way into us as readers, and how it really was all joy. And so I toast your contagious joy. And in this time when we worry about contagions and the things we might catch from one another, I want to thank you for helping us to catch these stories that bring the word alive through the ways that Dan embodied the gospel ethic of nonviolence with courage and creativity and humility and humor and poetry. Thank God for poetry and liturgical direct action and joy. So to the way that you tell a story, the way that one story calls forth another, quickening memory and somehow bringing us all into the room and asking us to contemplate being co-conspirators and even friends with Dan, with you, and with each other, we enter into the work and the joy of living into the freedom of the kingdom. So to the author of Celebrant's Flame, Bill Wylie-Kellermann, I lift my glass and my heart.
Denise, thank you. And thank you, Bill, for the magnificent book. I guess I have a little toast that will come at the end, but mostly I have an artwork that I want to share. And what better night to share it, and with what better of a group of people? Indeed, most of the people I know wouldn't get it, but I think you all might. So as many longtime friends of Dan know, he was a great lover of art and a great collector of art. And I mean, the apartment at 98th Street, the cottage on Black Island, floor to ceiling, fascinating, beautiful things to look at. And I have to confess, much of it is just gone. You know, he moved to Thompson Street. He moved from Thompson Street to Murray Weigel, and in those movements, the art dissipated. And you know, we're okay, but we miss it, and it's out there somewhere. At any rate, I have a piece here that I'm going to share with you in a moment. The last time I was in Uncle Dan's apartment on 98th Street was the day after Peter DeMott's funeral. I came east after we got the terrible news of Peter's sudden death. And we were in Ithaca for a couple of days. And then I went to New York with my sisters and wound up having a morning with Dan. And we were really cooking in our visit such that I seriously considered just blowing off my flight and figuring it out later. But of course we had very young kids at home and to do so would be unfair. So I didn't. But in our last sojourn there on 98th Street, he said, I want to give you something. And he gave me a little sculpture that I'm going to share with you in a moment. The story goes that he was teaching a class on Revelation at Berea College. And he assigned a paper to his students that they are to describe the manifestations of the beast figure in Revelation. And you know, it seems to me that we're coming out of 4 years of dealing with the demonic, dealing with the beast in a very profound way in our country. And this is just out of Revelation 13. The people worshiped the dragon because he had given authority to the beast. and they also worshiped the beast and asked, who is like the beast? Who can make war against the beast? The beast was given a mouth to utter proud words and blasphemies and to exercise his authority for 42 months. And we have just endured our 42 months, friends, and we made it through, thank God. Not everyone was so lucky, right? So in this class in Berea College, Dan had a student who came to him and said, I'm not really much of a writer, but I'm a sculptor. And I wonder if I could write the paper in wood and submit my reflection as a sculpture. And Dan said, you know, he was delighted, right? Of course you can do that. And that was the piece that he gave me. So this is the figure of the beast in Revelation. Here we have a human figure underneath supporting this one, right? And, you know, just a couple of reflections on this piece. You know, we'll see that the human figure is strong, right? The human figure is strong. Big, capable hands, carrying the weight in its core, right? Up to the burden, not crushed, right? Nevertheless, the human figure is pretty effectively pinned, right? And the beast sits there. And the beast has many names. The names of the beast are legion, right? So as I look at this piece, I'm reminded of what? Technocratic totalitarianism, right? We are watching you. The national security state. Full spectrum military dominance. Drone strikes. Militarized police. Derek Chauvin. White supremacy, generational poverty, subprime mortgage lending, and so on and so on and so on. And with Dan in mind, I'd like to raise a glass to those who will not be forgotten. Dan would not forget the people whose labor is stolen. We remember them tonight. We raise a glass to them. We will do what we can. We're human. We remain unbroken. And the time will come. Cheers.
I guess it's our turn. Greetings from the Ventura River watershed in Chumash territory in Southern California. Jed Nalane here. Congratulations, Bill, on another exercise in keeping the word of and about a keeper of the word. Dan's centenary tonight gathers us again like a bottle of scotch on 98th Avenue or in a Calvin College dormitory once upon a time.
Dear siblings on this call, we live in a time that has forgotten holy persons. Surrounded as we are by the claims and choreography of powerful people of quite different character and conviction. How uncommonly blessed were we then to have touched the hem of Dan's garment or Paisley shirts, and of Liz and Phil's too, to have been adopted into their kingdom of gospel faith and ethos of resistance. The profound depth of those relationships is evident in the affect and emotion exhibited by every speaker tonight. We are so hungry for the hospitality, attention, and love of holy people today. So how uncommonly fortunate we are to be, as Kathy Kelly put it, one of his.
The most apostolic duty they taught us was to keep up one another's courage. And I'd add, to keep telling their story, passing it on to rising hands and hearts, as you've done in this good book, Bill. So thanks for your labor and for all the ways you keep the word and its keepers and doers. Yes and no to the whole damn thing, eh? So happy birthday, Dan. God danced the day you were born, and the dance goes on.
Kid Lydia. I'm giggling at Lydia. We know that. We know that story, Lydia.
I just wanted to be at the party.
So I think I'm up next. This is Joyce Holiday, and I remember many, many years ago when Dan sent a poem to us at Sojourners Magazine right after he had gotten his first computer. And he attached a note to it that said, wrote this on a word processor, seems a little jumbled. Maybe I got a food processor by mistake. But of course, the poem wasn't jumbled. It was clear and true and prophetic, as all of Dan's poems are. I think that he is probably the least jumbled person I ever knew. He knew what was true. He knew what his vocation was. He knew what faith required of him. And he knew what it means to be human. And my prayer for all of us is that we would come to that same clarity. And thanks to you, Bill, for helping us to see it, to remember it in Dan, and to carry it forward. And may we all do the same. Cheers to Dan, to Bill, and to all.
Hi, I'm Tim Nafziger, he, him, here in the Ventura River watershed on unceded Chumash land. It's really beautiful to be in this space with you all. And I didn't think I had much to say, but I wanted to make a connection that I haven't heard anyone else make. And that is, it goes through some of what Kathy Kelly talked about earlier, and Sister Ann Montgomery came up a number of times, but I didn't have a lot of direct contact with the Berrigan brothers, but through Christian peacemaker teams, and particularly the lineage of Ann Montgomery, just tremendous impact from the Plowshares movement and the Catholic worker community on the growth of that organization that's been really influential for me. So just wanted to testify to the ripples of Dan's life and how that's impacted whole communities. And since there doesn't seem to be a lot of folks from Christian peacemaker teams here tonight, I just thought I'd shout out from that community and just really honoring the peacemaker, radical Christian peacemaking work that continues through today. Thanks.
Thank you, Tim. If there's anyone else who would like to say a brief word, it doesn't have to be anything rehearsed, you're welcome to basically either put your name in the chat or just hop on.
Kia ora, tēnā koutou e ho mā. Can you hear me? No. You can? I'm in New Zealand, Aotearoa. And Dan Berrigan influenced us in terms of the church, the the young movements were involved, young worker movements, young student movements, and he would resonate often in terms of people reading short bits of his poetry or just talking about what he was doing. And I guess listening to the presentations, it's quarter to one here in Aotearoa in the afternoon. The presentations in terms of how Dan Berrigan and a lot of people who work with him and stood with him enabled them to become Christ as he was, and in terms of the ongoing struggle. I mean, we as protesters and activists were locked up for overnight sort of thing, not the years that some of you people have been locked up in terms of standing up for justice. We often read the poem Some at church because it reminds us the power of being active and the power of living the gospel. And one thing that's going on here is young Pacific Island women who live in New Zealand, who are Catholics, are becoming involved in social justice things like living wage campaign, union expansion campaigns, those sorts of things. And it's linking in the stuff that Dan was talking about. There's some research, a book's been written here of activists, most of who have long left the church, but are involved with unions and peace and all sorts of stuff. So this woman, Mary Ellen O'Connor, is writing these people's story. And these stories resonate with what Dan was on about, but also about what we've been involved here in Aotearoa. So thanks for the book, Bill, and thanks for this presentation, and great to hear people talking who physically knew Phil as opposed to people like me who just read about him. Thank you. Ka kite ana.
Hi, I'm Kathy Boylan. I don't know if I can get on.
Yep, you're on.
Oh, hi. As I said, I'm Kathy Boylan. I'm here at Dorothy Day Catholic Worker in DC. And I was 24 years old on May 17th, 1968, when I turned on the radio. Many people have heard this story. Turned on the radio and heard of Dan and Phil and the Catonsville Nine action. And I literally stood up a different person. I had no background in, you know, it was just totally miraculous for me. I don't know why I was so drawn to it. And then I pursued trying to find them, which seemed to be difficult. But anyway, I did get connected. And so that's one thing. I celebrate that May 17th, 1968. We're coming up to an anniversary of Catonsville. But finally, on Plowshares, I once heard Dan say, in quoting, you know, they shall beat their swords into plowshares, their spears into pruning hooks. They will study war never again. And Dan said, and who are these they who are going to show up to do this work, if not us? So that connected with me too. It said, of course, that's exactly what I should be thinking of. But anyway, I celebrate. I'm so blessed that I had a chance to meet Dan and Phil and everyone on this call and all the people who will come after in the future. Hopefully, I was really touched by what Eric Martin said. He changed my life. I don't know if I changed anything about his life, but he certainly changed mine. So thank you, everyone.
This is Dwyer Sullivan calling from Kitchener. Uh-oh. And with Kathy on there, I've been able to take students to the Dorothy Day House, and also through her experience, through her encouragement, have gone on several Berrigan retreats, which I really learned from Liz and Phil and Dan. But a special way that Dan is in our hearts on his 100th birthday is that my wife of 46 years has the same birthday. And we've known that forever. Another good friend of ours, Sylvia Stripchek, has her birthday on Phil Berrigan's birthday. And so the four of us celebrate those birthdays without Dan ever knowing it forever. And the fact that my wife was born on Mother's Day, and today, May 9th, is Mother's Day again, it's been a wonderful gathering for our family. So we just give credit to the conviction of nonviolence and peacemaking. And like the judge in John Deere's story, most of Dan Berrigan's poetry was over my head, but I knew it was good stuff. And so anyway, thank you for this program on Dan. It was just wonderful to all the people that know him better than I. So thank you all.
Can I tell a story?
Of course.
Jim Wallace, I'm here in Washington, D.C. It's so wonderful to spend the evening with all of you and see your faces and hear your stories. I just thought of a story as you were all talking. Being with Dan Berrigan, and particularly Berrigan and Stringfellow, was wonderful when they were doing their, I would say, political commentary. And how it was so different from all the other political commentary that we hear and are controlled by. And I remember once I happened to be out there and staying with Bill, but Dan was in the cottage making dinner for us. And we went back to the cottage, and Dan made this, as you remember, these enormous, wonderful meals. Then we sat down and watched the presidential debate between Gerald Ford and Jimmy Carter. Watching a presidential debate with Daniel Berrigan and William Stringfellow is like no other commentary I'd ever heard or have ever heard since about political discussion. Mm-hmm. And they just basically full of humor, full of prophetic, passion, but full of humor as well. And it just sort of turned the whole thing upside down. And we have now, we're always controlled by political commentary. And the commentary going on right now is some of the worst it's ever been, even about what we've been through and what it means and doesn't mean. And I often miss conversations around the Stringfellow table, which I have now in my dining room, where we used to always sit and talk about political commentary. So I miss the political commentary of Dan Berrigan, and particularly with that lawyer Stringfellow alongside. So I remembering that tonight and wish we had more of that. So, and what a wonderful evening, Bill. Thanks so much for the book and for all of you, and all your stories just made my day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jim. And I'm passing it to Bill Hartman now. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Terry. Thank you. So just about maybe three things to think about for myself. When I left the Catholic Seminary in Philadelphia, about a year after I left, I moved to New York, and I was living in Emmaus House in New York City, and would go over to 98th Street where Joe O'Rourke and Pete Forty and Ed McGowan and Dan and many others, Bob Keck and so forth, were occasionally haunting the place. And so I got to meet and get to know Dan after he came out of prison there at that location, and the other guys that were part of that household. I went out with Judy Peluso and Karen Lydon, who were part of the Emmaus House, but also Sisters of Charity. And we would go out to Harrisburg to support the Harrisburg Eight at the time, to be in concert with them and supportive during Vietnam days. 1982, when Art Laffin, myself, Ann Montgomery, so many others, we went and did the Trident Plowshare action. My parents came to that. They were befuddled and confused by the experience of what was I doing, and trying to understand that piece of why I was so motivated. And Dan and Phil both, during the trial, one day that they were there with us, sat with them at lunch and spent probably a good hour at lunchtime just sitting in a cafe someplace and talking with my parents and just expressing the concerns that they were seeing and why all of us, the nine of us who were part of that action, were there and what our presence was about. And it converted my parents' hearts and minds as well. So they were able to come home back to Pennsylvania and embrace a different way of understanding my life and what we were about from those days. And then finally, this the many a times that Dan would, I'm thinking of Dan, but when Dan would come to Philadelphia, John McNamee, who's also having a birthday today, and celebrated that with Daniel all the time. And he would come to McNamee's church, St. Malachy's, give community talks and do other events in Philadelphia. And we would sit in the dining room and toast what life was about. embrace and share that kiss of peace that we all have known of Dan in terms of what his life was for all of us and how much he expressed the belief in a new sense of hope. He was never about despair. He was always about finding hope amidst despair. He never wanted to, he recognized the despair was out there, but he didn't want to embrace that, but he wanted always to embrace hope and challenge us as his community around him to embrace that as well. The statue of Franz Jagerstetter that was done for Daniel by Bob McGovern still exists and rests in St. Malachy's Church in Philadelphia, in front of the Blessed St. Franz. Is he's not a saint yet, but he's blessed by the church, and it sits at the church there. Dan sent it down to McNamee because he knew he couldn't keep it at 98th Street, and he wanted him to have it because of their familial and fraternal relationship that they had. So it exists there to the day. And I thank you for this time, Bill. It was great to be with you and Denise and so many of other friends who are part of this community and so embraced by all of it. And God bless you all. Thank you. David, you're on.
Me. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yeah. We can't hear you anymore. It might have muted again.
It says mute. Can you hear me?
Go. Yep.
Mm-hmm. All right. Dave Eberhart, I'm now 80 and poured blood with Phil in Baltimore, 1967. And great thanks to Bill, and so rewarding to be among so many old and new friends. I would offer two photos from my book. One is George Mishy, Phil and Dan in the hallowed underground. Myself, Phil and Dan in the hallowed underground. Bill Ayers of the Weather Underground says, yes, we were comrades. Anyway, our my time, Phil's, was short-lived, but thank you so much, Bill, and congrats on the book. We need more publicity for our stories. Media is missing in action, friends. But thank you so much.
Thank you, Dave. And I saw that Bernadette was raising your hand. Would you still like to speak?
Yes, I would. Thank you so much. I'm just so grateful to be here this evening for this wonderful event. Thank you, Bill. And I feel like just being in your midst is like hitting a home run from third base, and I really and truly appreciate it. I had an opportunity to meet both Phil and Dan in my 20s, when I was working at a community action place in Baltimore. And I did not realize, but as I'm sitting here tonight and listening, you know, I feel like for some reason I find myself in the right place at the right time. I also met Thich Nhat Hanh in an elevator in Vietnam when he was returning to Vietnam for his first retreat. And the same Mother Teresa came to Arlington, Virginia to give a speech. And I was asked to be at that. And I had an opportunity to shake her hand, and she blessed my daughter. And I feel I'm kind of in that kind of place tonight. Thank you so much for this wonderful book, for the opportunity. And as I'm sitting here, I'm thinking, how many people am I passing by today, tonight, who are the future Dan Berrigans, Mother Teresa's, Thich Nhat Hanh's of the future, you know, to be recognized and to be seen by me, by all of us, and just given that opportunity. So thank you so much for this wonderful, wonderful celebration and all the people who know him and know you and know Denise. And I truly appreciate being here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bernadette, and everyone for sharing. Are there any other folks who would like to say a last word? We're probably getting low on our drinks for toasting at this point. I don't know about y'all, but feel free to jump in with a final word if you'd like.
I could share, if I may. I don't know if you can. You hear me? Hi. I'm not sure if I can be heard.
Yes, we can hear you.
Thank you. Paul Frazier here with Peg Gafal, the Arkport Catholic Worker. And I had the incredible opportunity to grow up as an altar boy under the tutelage of Father Edmund Berrigan, Dan and Phil's uncle. And one of the first actions that I ever was privileged to take part in was about 1952, when a new church was being built in Phoenix, New York, right outside of Syracuse. And Father Berrigan was there with the bishop, and they were digging the grounds for the new church. And he had invited his two nephews, Phil and Dan, to be there. And together they dug a little bit of the new church. And it was a symbol of looking back years later. And for many years, I lived in Syracuse and had the blessings of being very close with Jerry Berrigan and being arrested with him a few times at Hancock and over at Rome Air Force Base. And it somehow just has tied together for me, going back to Dan and Phil digging an action of sorts, a new church. And I think somehow continued that digging through their whole lives in different forms, in different fashions. So it's a real blessing for me to have known Dan and Phil and really particularly Jerry, who was one of the funnier of the Berrigans, and a real blessing to Bill for the book. And reading the book is like a homecoming for me. And it's just an incredible journey, having been involved with the Catholic Workers and with Dan and Phil. So blessings to everyone here, and God bless.
I think I'll stick my nose in and say one last word of thank you to everyone who came tonight, who spoke, who it's just such a great circle of folks that I love and I'm proud to be connected with in wide and ineffable beloved community. Thanks for showing up. Thanks for helping. Thanks to Denise. Thanks to Lydia and Lucy, Heidi, all the folks who were working behind this thing. I love you all. I drink to you. And I hope to see you soon.
Congrats, Bill.
Thank you.
Amen, brother. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you all.
God bless you.
Great job.
Thank you.
Happy birthday, Dan.
Happy birthday, Dan.
Birthday.
Always.
I'm pretty much off. Am I?
Yep.
Night all.
Chad Myers, a Dodgers fan.
Great evening.
Good night.
Thank you.
Bill Kellermann.
Bill?
Yeah.
My name's Steve Oldham. I'm sorry. I spent a few minutes trying to dig up a poem that I don't think you've heard before that Dan wrote in 1980.
Did you get it?
Dan wrote a poem in 1980 after he was disinvited from St. Joseph's University to give a talk.
Right.
Bill Hartman is part of the CPF crew that protested outside of St. Joe's. It was going to be a talk arranged by my wife at the Peace Justice Institute at St. Joe's.
Yep.
And she was going to have Dan and Archbishop, the bishop from O'Connor from New York, who's the military vicarate at the time.
Debate.
Kind of a back and forth. At the last minute, St. Joe's disinvited him. And so in kind of response to that disinvitation by the Jesuits, he wrote this poem called St. Josephina. Do you want me to read it? It's short.
Please.
I decided to make a poem of a definitely unpropitious hour when I came on this letter, return address, St. Josephina's University, Department of Peace and Justice, Philadelphia. Oh, I said to myself, this is bound to be not good news. Dear brother in Christ, he wrote, this is starting off very bad. I said to myself, I am hereby obliged, he wrote, to disinvite you from the Department of Peace and Justice of St. Josephina's. You understand, he wrote, the faculty regarding the matter of your coming are down in the mouth. The alumni are up in arms. Between mouths down and arms up, he wrote, I am caught. Hence this note. Please disregard prior invitation. This is your disinvitation. You understand, he wrote, we at St. Josephina, you, admire you immensely. This matter is by no means to be taken personally. In fact, I personally pray for you practically continually. This is sure going badly, I said to myself. In conclusion, he wrote, please be assured, for on the difficult road you have been chosen for, I will pray for you. You, I sure do pray for. Ouch, said I to myself. This is painful. This brother in Christ is praying for me. He's undoubtedly expert in voodoo arts. Presently, he's sticking pine into my private parts.
Thank you.
Just wanted to share with you. I was looking for it in the last half hour, so my wife came up with it in her archives.
That's great.
That's great.
Peace.
Love everybody. Thank you for coming.
Yeah, thanks.
Thanks very much, Bill.
Hi, Jane.
Goodbye to all. Good night.
What's that? Should we leave? I'm staying until everybody's gone.
You know the difference between the English and the Irish, Bill.
I was thinking the same thing. The grady line is the English leave and never say goodbye. The Irish say goodbye and never leave.
And I always think, have fun storming the castle. They'll never meet.
Oh my gosh. I want to just say, I haven't seen the book yet. I've been moving around a lot since I left Georgia in, I guess it was the early March. And I'm really grateful for how you began this conversation with the 1964 meeting, which Dad was a part of. Just realizing, I did an interview with Claire and Marianne about their childhood since they're older and wanting to know a little bit more about life before I came into the picture. And one of the things I remember Marianne saying in her recollection was they would go to mass at Fordham, where Dan, they were good friends already by this time. Dan and I guess Dad met Dan the night Marianne was born, which was 1956. So there was a long friendship there for a very long time. And they had a really great, rich love for the Gospels and for their, you know, with their faith as part of their food that they shared with each other. And so Marianne says that she remembers lots of very not heated, but very engaged conversations after mass right there on the Fordham campus with Dan and Dad and Mom and other people. And of course, this would have been probably before John was born, which was 1960. So just knowing that, and then of course, having all of the wonderful, wonderful parties that happened at our apartment in the Bronx, and where Dan and Phil would come and visit. And of course, I was baptized by Dan and Phil in 1965, though I didn't, I mean, I have this very strange memory of being taken out of the bedroom, which was my parents' bedroom, and brought into the foyer of the apartment and having Phil looking at me and saying how beautiful she was. but this was just a child's memory, and I don't have any reason to know why. I always thought it was a dream, and Mom always said that it was probably the baptism, and that I was probably being brought out after a nap or something after they had a party at the apartment. But there was just something really powerful that you mentioned about that meeting that Martin Luther King and Rustin Bayern were supposed to be there. And it just kind of like just rekindled my desire for being down in Georgia and recognizing the need for bringing together the conversations, you know, the racism aspect to the conversation keeps getting left out, but is fomenting, I would say, down there in Georgia. And so it was is a very strong reason and pull for me to stay down there, even though I'm in LA right now. But
work down there.
Say that again.
I said I so appreciate the work you've been doing there.
It's definitely felt rich, and you're speaking tonight and just kind of describing how you begin the book just kind of affirms that work. So thank you. And and now I actually want to read your book. So I'll have to have it sent to LA because I don't know how long I may be here a little longer than I anticipated. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Who else is on here? See, I can't see anybody else because where's Ellen?
Thanks again to Kateri for hosting, especially for managing the last section there. I was glad I could just sit back and listen. That was a great gift.
And Kateri, you began with saying something about how you grew up in this, but never really paid attention or feel like you're just coming into it. I can't. And what was, when you said that, it actually, it was at Mom's funeral, which was just 20 days before Dan died. So it was not that long ago that we were sitting saying prayers, you know, the rosary at Mom's wake, when I confessed that summer, it was the previous summer when Syria was being bombed, and I had this revelation at that age. Right now I'm already in my 50s by this time, and I have, having grown up in this having been baptized by Dan and Phil Berrigan, my middle name is Berrigan, and it wasn't until I was 50 that, as I'm seeing the images of Syria being bombed, I think to myself, those weapon manufacturers ought to be criminalized. and it was like the first time in my mind, like as though I haven't been protesting at the Pentagon or at Lockheed Martin or anywhere else. You'd think that I had just figured it out. So I just want to encourage you to just keep going, because there are many facets to the understanding, and it keeps happening, which is a good thing.
Thank you for that. Yeah, I appreciate that a lot.
All right, Denise, Jean Palumbo is still hanging in from Salvador.
I know.
Wow.
Are you going to say something, Jean?
You know, I was just remembering a story about Dan that I think it captures something about him. I had met him at the New York City Worker after he got out of Danbury and would come down to say mass. And then I, in 1980, came here to El Salvador. And one day in 84, I was up in one of the press offices in the press hotel. This is in the middle of the war. And the bellhop from downstairs comes up and says, "There's a phone call for you from New York City. I don't know who it is." And I went down, and it was Dan. And he said, "You know, I just think I need to understand more what's really happening in El Salvador and Nicaragua. I just don't know enough. If I came down for a month, would you set up my visit and translate for me?" So I said, "Yeah." So we wound up having a month of being together 24/7. And you can imagine what that was like. But the specific story that I remember was, one day we're in Nicaragua, it was early morning up in the area where the Contra were coming across the border from Honduras. And somehow or other, he got talking about something that, who was it referred to earlier about how his reception among his brother Jesuits was not always positive. And he told me that one time, one of the higher ups, I don't remember exactly who, called him in. And after beating around the bush a bit, the guy finally says, "Dan, you know, have you thought maybe about just, you know, leaving the Jesuits, just going away, leaving the Jesuits?" And Dan says, I said to him, "Well, no, actually, I haven't. Have you?" And then he said, 5 years later, the same guy called him in again. And it was the same routine. He kind of hedges for a while. And then he finally says, "Dan, haven't you thought about maybe leaving the Jesuits?" And Dan says, I said to him, "You know, it makes me so happy to hear you say that. And if you don't keep saying it to me every 5 years or so, I'm going to worry that I've grown slack in my priestly vocation." And I just said, you know, that's Dan. That's all. Yeah. Thanks for organizing this. I just remember back being in that class with Dan together. I was kind of the auditor or whatever I was coming down from the Bronx. But so I guess what, we go back about 50 years, huh? So it's great to see you again. It was great to visit you in Detroit a few years ago. And I hope we can do it again if Guadalupe and I ever get up there.
This was so lovely. Thank you. Thank you all so much.
Thanks.
I'll say good night. And
yeah, us too. We've got people in the morning.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
We have the kitchen in the morning here.
Early morning.
Early. Love to all.